guys, it's time for the rank for the kill count of Five Nights at Freddy's. Have not seen it yet, so here we go.
Welcome to the Kill Count, where we tally up the victims in all our favorite horror movies and show you how they were made. I'm James A. Janisse, and today we're looking at Five Nights at Freddy's.
Sorry, I don't want to get a DVD.
Five Nights at Freddy's, or FNAF to fans, is based on the viral video game franchise of the same name. FNAF takes place at Freddy Fazbear's Pizza, a Chuck E. Cheese-style restaurant played by animatronic Animosity. It's hard to know where to start with FNAF. Released in 2014, the indie horror game Five Nights at Freddy's was created in just 6 months by a single man, Scott Cawthon, who at that point was developing family-friendly Christian adventure games. One of his efforts, Chipper and Sons Lumber Co., was criticized for its unintentionally creepy characters, so Cawthon decided to repurpose the art style for a horror game. Five Nights quickly blossomed into a full-on media franchise, currently consisting of 9 main games, multiple spin-off games, novels, comics, an ass-load of merchandise, and a haunted house in Las Vegas. What? FNAF's success is due in part to its complicated lore, which has been picked apart and analyzed by countless internet sleuths. With such a rabid fanbase, a film adaptation was all but inevitable. But it languished in development hell for many years, going back to 2015. Blumhouse finally delivered the long-awaited project in October 2023, and even though it was available on Peacock opening day, it grossed nearly $300 million worldwide. I never got into Five Nights, but I was happy to see this movie's success. I think the acting is solid and that it shot well, thanks to the cast and the direction by Emma Tammy. And the animatronics, created by the geniuses at the Jim Henson Creature Shop, are absolutely incredible. They look like they were ripped straight out of the games. But I've only played the first game a couple of times.
Me too.
If you don't know the lore, this movie is confusing and, honestly, pretty slow. As a film, I found it kind of mid. But the truth is, it doesn't fucking matter what I think. This thing was made for the fans. And by all accounts, those fans seem to love it. So I'm thrilled for that.
I knew we needed to make a movie that was going to land with the fans, and that was Jason Blum's priority and Scott's as well.
I mean, this gets kids excited to it's watch just, it's his baby. Talking and kick-ass practical animatronics, then yes, make a million more, please. Especially since it doesn't dumb things down for its younger audience, even though it's not overly complicated. It's got foreshadowing and themes and good lighting. It's a fine little movie, and I'm happy that it made so many people happy. Will our characters survive their 5 nights with Freddy,
yes,
or will they punch out early from their security shift? Let's find out and get to the
movie. Pretty good. The movie I thought was pretty good. I should buy the movie. Because the movie was okay.
The movie begins with a Chuck E. chase. A security guard is crawling and walking his way through Freddy Fazbear's Pizza because he's done with the monitor monitoring and whatever's on the other side of that door.
Close up.
I think it's something. Foxy!
Oh!
Dum Dum cannot run those Dum Dums, so he gets knocked out and strapped down. He's about to be put in an animatronic suit, and you know what they say about those masks.
So you can imagine what having your head forcibly pressed inside one of those could cause a bit of discomfort and death.
The guard is killed when the mask gives him an off-screen Fazbear facial. What to you? 8-bit opening credits pay homage to the arcade minigames.
Number two!
And several of the FNAF sequels. They
number
show
two.
Someone suited up as a yellow bunny. Wonder who? Peeling kids off from her friends one by one. Where you taking them, bunny? Where's the sprite string? Mike Schmidt is also a security guard, only he works at the local mall. That is, until he witnesses what seems to be a kidnapping, which causes him to hulk out and baptize the guy with a beatdown. Unfortunately, he misread the situation. Come on, Mike, what the fuck was that?
That was a mistake.
Yeah, it was. I've got Shaggy yelling at you. He's fired and has a meeting with a career counselor named Steve Raglan. Yeah, okay, gout. Steve, totally his real name, is played by Matthew Lillard, a 2-time Kill Count veteran and 1-time Prime Rib presenter. Thanks again for that, man. Steve is initially dismissive, since Schmidt is a shit employee, but for some reason, his tune changes after seeing Mike's last name.
I have a job for you.
Maybe you noticed that Mike is named after the first game's protagonist. He offers Mike a security shift at Freddy Fazbear's Pizza.
You only have to worry about one thing.
The killer animatronics.
Keeping people out.
Oh, I could have sworn it was the killer animatronics. Steve sells the job as a real winner.
How's the pay?
Not great. But the hours are worse.
Those hours are the graveyard shift, which Mike says he can't work. He needs to prioritize his nightly routine, which consists of pills, posters, and nature sounds. All this ambience is to help him lucidly dream about a childhood camping trip. He was supposed to be watching over his little brother Garrett, but got distracted and didn't notice when Garrett went off with a stranger. Not even aging into PETA is enough for Mike to change the past, and his dream always ends with Garrett's abduction. But he thinks that by visiting the incident in his dreams, he might remember a clue he's forgotten, and finally find out what's happened to his bro. Mike is now the guardian of his little sister Abby, who likes dinosaurs bungalows and building tents. They have an Aunt Jane who thinks Mike shouldn't be watching over the youngin', even though he's a well-meaning guy. I mean, besides the whole assaulting a dad thing. Quit crying, kid. He was doing it because he cares. The shopping mauling gives Aunt Jane a name to claim Abby for herself, hoping to collect them foster child funds. She intends on taking sole custody of Abby with the help of her fearsome lawyer, Doug. Tremble before him! Knowing that he'll need to look good in front of a judge, Mike calls up Steve Ragland to take him up on his job offer. We're less than 20 minutes into this thing, and we're already at Freddy's. I love how we ain't fazzy-footing around. Mike's first night begins with a phone call from Steve, giving him the lowdown.
This place was huge in the 80s with the kids.
Steve's phone call is in the style of Phone Guy. Your supervisor in the game supervises you with instructions and voicemail. This place's security system is dated but extensive, with cameras and lights everywhere. Except probably right outside the office. And of course, since this is FNAF, the power situation ain't great.
The electricity is a bit iffy.
Mike settles into the office, which is a mostly accurate rendition of the one from the game, complete with a fan, striped sippy drink, and ball of tinfoil. The only unrealistic thing is that Mike's not booping the nose on that Celebrate poster. Production designer Mark Fisichella added tons of set deck Easter eggs, including a prize counter filled with the second game's Funtime animatronics and a nod to Chica's Magic Rainbow, the main antagonist of FNAF World. A spin-off RPG. Freddy's uses the Jigsaw employee training technique, so Mike pops his tape in and watches a retro training video. The video covers the Disneyland level tech that goes into Fazbear's animatronics, but right when it's turning into a How It's Made on dancing robots, the tape gets spooky, so Mike doesn't fully see them in action. All he knows is that he must protect his proprietary technology, a job duty that doubles as a tongue twister. FNAF's dedication to its source material was guided by the game's creator, Scott Coffin. He co-produced the movie and helped keep the lore and animatronic design true to the IP. He also wrote the initial draft of the screenplay, which director Emma Tammy and co-writer Seth Cutback then expanded on to flesh out the characters and story. Instead of doing his job, Mike keeps up his nightly routine of trauma dreaming. It's the same old until Mike stumbles upon five little birthday guests, tries to pry them for information.
Did you see you took my brother?
But their response is less than helpful. Mike wakes up and ends his shift when the clock strikes 6 o'clock.
Yay!
He returns home to relieve his babysitter, Max, not knowing that she's been working with Aunt Jane to collect evidence against Mike. She and her brother, Jeff, meet with Jane at a diner, where they're waiting for the YouTuber, MadPat.
You do realize that lunch is the most important meal of the day.
Thought it was breakfast.
Some people say that, but, you know, it's just a theory.
It's a well-deserved cameo, seeing as his game theory videos helped kick off FNAF's explosive success. In fact, MadPat's cameo was the very first scene filmed for the movie. Matt's not the only FNAF creator featured in the film. The Employee of the Month wall in the background includes several streamers, like 8-Bit Ryan, Razbowski, Baz, Fusion Z Gamer, and Dokko. Markiplier was also asked to appear as the security guard who bites it in the opening sequence, but he had to turn it down to work on his own upcoming horror film, Iron Lung. Max can't find any evidence of wrongdoing, so Jane pays them to fuck with Mike's employment by trashing the pizzeria. Then he'll get fired, and she can take custody. It's the perfect illegal plan.
I just realized I shouldn't be hearing any of this.
On his second night, Mike gets right back to sleep manifesting on the job. But the little dream warriors run away again. One little pirate even gives them the hook and a scare bear stare. Mike wakes up to see a police officer at the door, trying to buzz her way inside.
About time. Something maybe fussy on the job.
What? Who? Me? Never. This is Vanessa, a local cop who seems to know more about Freddy's than she's letting on. She sees that Mike has a cut on his arm, the same one that he got in his dream. But this Five Nights at Freddy Krueger shit never comes up again. What the fuck's that all about? She gives Mike the grand tour of the restaurant, including a performance by its robo band. The song they sing is Talking in Your Sleep by The Romantics, an earwormy reference to Mike's sleeping habits. It plays several times in the film, which is great. I love when movies have a signature needle drop, like in Your Next, Us, and The Lost Boys. The band includes the four animatronics from the original game. Guitarist Bonnie, a blue bunny, not voiced by Zoran, Chica, a chicken on backup vocals, who has a sidekick named Mr. Cupcake, Party Pirate Foxy, who I guess is just there for, vibes, and the band leader, Freddy Fazbear himself. Tammy knew from the get-go the animatronics would be the focal point of the film.
They are part of the cast, sure. And the characters that the fans are the most familiar with, actually, going into this film.
The difficult task of bringing them to life went to the team at Jim Henson's Creature Shop, under the supervision of lead designer Robert Bennett. The team created full-sized animatronics of the mascots, as well as suits worn by stunt performers. Jade Kindar-Martin played Bonnie, Jess Weiss played Chica, and Kevin Foster played Freddy. Foster's actually been added to the kill count before in Jurassic World. It wasn't easy for them to perform in these heavy suits.
I have a helmet that's about 16 pounds, and I call it a helmet because it's full. I'm in there, and I don't really have any visibility whatsoever.
Occasionally, puppeteers had to step in to operate their arms and hands, while additional performers controlled the eyes, ears, and mouth off-screen. Even though this jam session rocks, things aren't all fun and games at the pizzeria. Vanessa mentions that some kids went missing there in the 80s, which grabs Mike's attention, since missing kids is kind of his whole thing. But she drives off before they can unravel that thread, leaving Mike to lock up for the day. He's spied on by Max's brother Jeff, who initiates Operation Fuck Up Fazbear's. He and his gang of ruffians break into the pizzeria and promptly start causing all sorts of trouble. Wait, how do you wind up with this group of people? Like, how do they know this guy? A dude named Carl is poking through the kitchen when he's jump-scared by Chica, who promptly sinks Mr. Cupcake on him. His buddy Hank hears the commotion and discovers Carl getting his face skin licked off like Frosty. Jeff is hanging out in the security room when he sees Hank on the monitor screaming like a maniac. Hank tries to hide, but winds up locking himself in with Bonnie, who reduces him to a bloody version of the Titanic handprint. Jeff arrives just in time to see Boogie Bunny Bonnie emerging from the closet. He runs away and holds up in the security room, where he narrowly avoids a sneak attack by Mr. Cupcake. In the games, Mr. Cupcake is basically a static prop, but he's promoted to full-on killer robot status in the movie. Director Tammy admitted production was a little obsessed with Cupcake, who was able to be incorporated into more scenes due to his size. Jeff tries to escape, but is foiled by a locked door. Sucks for him, since the Scat Man's on his way again. The Dum Dums come courtesy of Foxy, who hums a similar ditty in the original game. He runs down the hallway and puts an end to Jeff with another move ripped from his in-game behavior.
Okay, we have to stop watching this, guys. I have to go to work. I'll finish this later. Thanks for watching.